you mentioned focusing on building trust, social capital, but given the contradictory motives of the social objectives of possibly of the state and community and the profit making motives of the sector, is there any way that that can be resolved? Should we have a few questions and discussion? Is there anything else?
Yeah.
Anyone else? Or maybe not?
No, it's just very interesting to see the similarities, and all the PPPs, I think they suffer or are afflicted with the same similar kind of issues, which then I think crystallizes to the power relation, differential power relation, and the culture of institutions. So, it's very interesting that it's getting re-emphasized. So, what next? There's this question, because if, as you said, that nothing has changed, and we see that things are not changing, more and more interest groups are coming into the picture. So what next? That is the question.
So I'm wondering also in the context of all that advocacy we see around India being, the model of PPPs, whether there is lessons beyond the health. I know roads were massive in terms of PPPs, and there's been massive failures in roads and PPPs in India in this setback. So whether there is, a sense of the Indian case being used in different places in the world to promote this, and whether you locate your own contributions, which are very critical, which tease out all these contradictions and problems within that broader kind of landscape of how do we understand the promotion of PPPs and almost the role that the Indian case tends to play and the problems across sectors.
So far, I know, I may be wrong, so please correct me. Healthcare and the private health insurance agencies, these are also part of healthcare services, right? So, what is their role? Is there any nexus in providing insurance by these private healthcare agencies? And what is that, their role in this context? I'm just curious to know.
Should we try one round?
Yeah.
To come back to your question of trust, I think that's a very interesting question, because where is the trust deficit today? The trust deficit really has been, I would say, partly created by a weak public sector, but it has also been created by the market. So what has happened is that trust has in a sense shifted from trust in a public system to a trust in a private system. Somehow this equation that if you pay more money, you get better care. And I think that perception has gained some amount of currency, which is why you find a lot of the large surveys, people saying that people are rude in the public sector, you don't get good medicines in the public sector. Now, not all of this is true. But having said that, you use the inefficiencies of the public sector to bolster this newfound trust in the private sector. And it interests me, because you raised this question, I kind of thought about it. So how do we, I think it's an interesting area to explore. So trust doesn't just come out of the vacuum. It comes out of experience, but it is also what I would call manufactured trust.
So I think it's quite a...
When you have weak public systems who themselves have commercialized, then who is going to advocate for public sector today?
Even the public sector isn't advocating for public sector.
Exactly. Because they have private interests. And this predates liberalization. In terms of government doctors practicing privately, running nursing homes, it's a mixed economy. The blurring of boundaries began much before liberalization.
Yeah, so I can't see you today, so I'm going to be busy, but it comes to my private clinic tomorrow.
That's right. So what is the perception of the person who seeks care? That I get better care if I see her in the private setting, rather than if I come to the government hospital.
Yeah.
which is overcrowded, which is where they are overburdened, where they are dealing with very poor infrastructure, not having adequate drugs. So, you know, I mean, that's why healthcare becomes very, very complex. So when you talk about effectiveness of outcomes, you cannot talk about effectiveness based only on the human resources component. So, yeah.
I'm also really, not really upset, but intrigued by this increasing notion among the public with respect to healthcare. If you're getting the facilities as in a hotel, or the treatment as you get, you know, that kind of welcome and things in a hotel.
Hospitality.
Yeah, hospitality. So, that is considered good healthcare, and though that would, in a way, could be really bad for the health of the person who's getting all those things. So, how?
Yeah, I think part of it was answered by Mari in the morning in education.
Yeah.
You know, the moment the middle class exits out of, so solidarity breaks down.
Yes.
So I think if you look at the Western European examples, like you wouldn't vote out an NHS. Right, you would not, in the Canadian case, despite all the liberalization, the Canadian healthcare system stood because there was a buy-in from the middle classes, the sense of solidarity. But that solidarity weakened even by the 80s in this country. I mean, I remember going to a government hospital as a child, but how many of us really go to the government hospital?
How many of us want to?
Yeah, well,
I'm doing work with AIMS.
Oh, you are?
Yeah. Around thousands of people every day.
Yeah, it's very, very difficult.
Cardiologists will work and see 100 patients a day.
So, you know, I mean, so I think that is the question. There's somebody raised the question about PPPs, the literature, right? Being showcased as a success. Well, maybe one of the reasons why there is so little work that you see emerging in the work that we presented. I mean, we've just brought together people who have worked on PPPs or interested through a critical lens is very small because the buy-in to PPPs is both the academic and the political elite. They're bought into the whole idea. And they don't want to, if they hear us, they'll say, oh, these people will always complain. They are always critical. Here we are trying to build the nation with PPPs and they're demolishing it. No, and the recent insurance scheme that has been announced, despite all the evidence which the government itself has and acknowledges, we are still pushing in for an American type of Medicare in an unregulated market. Any economist will tell you that's the worst thing you can do. But if you've decided that is the route you're going to take ideologically, and you're convinced about it, then that's how it is moving.
I like this is a remark. I like the point that you raised about the casualization of health workforce. I think after private intervention, that's something precarity, informality, casualization, temporariness that has just taken a rise in the.
No, and has a huge impact on quality of services.
Exactly, yeah.
You know, and we have some parallels in the case of education, in that case. And, you know, so what does it do to cultures of institutions? What does it do to having multiple work arrangements in an institution? So, you know, you have the permanent employees sitting with the contract employees and we've seen, and one of my students, Simi, is working on that, where she's looking at what is the dynamics that operates in a hospital when you have multiple work arrangements.
It sounds like the UK university.
Yes. So, you know, the whole thing of who is able to sort of command whom and then all of this, and who has the voice to speak up, and this whole thing of unionization that we heard. The resistances get fractured in such a situation.
Collective power or collective bargaining
is completely fractured.
Yeah, that's something which we need to look into if we are calling for such kind of interventions.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Just to take forward what Raman said about manufactured trust, and if you look at the policy paper, that actually says that it's based on evidence that this whole public government funded insurance schemes should be rolled out. There are how that kind of further gets pronounced is that the paper actually says that there's low public health expenditure, but doesn't say that the public health expenditure should be increased.
Mm-hmm.
Which is because there has been consistently low public health expenditure. Then it says that there's a huge reliance of the on the private sector, and this survey, that survey, you know, year after year, we know that people are going to the private sector. Then it contradicts itself by saying, despite all the investment in the public sector, people are still going to the private sector, and therefore, you know, we should purchase services from the private sector. Then it goes on to use what you said at the beginning in the overview about using the market principles, where it again very, I don't know if it's naive or what, but it's about saying that public sector also should be incentivized and bringing in the public-private competition. And lastly, it actually, and there's a whole section which says that by doing this, the state can control the behavior of the private sector. And I think that's the, you know, most flawed
contradictions.
So what you've not been able to do all these years through purchasing services, how are you going to regulate
this? I think an aspect we haven't covered and which I think will become very important to this whole PPP debate would be the way in which the private sector has built lobbies and has been, and the political class is complicit, you know, in this whole process. And so you, if we don't analyze that, we will not be, we otherwise end up saying, oh, the government is ineffective. I don't think it needs to be framed like that. The government is very effective because it has aligned with private interests. And you see this especially in medical education, in private medical education.
Huge.
Yes. Lobbies of
politicians who set up medical colleges.
Yeah, because I was going to say, like, in Chile, you can map very clearly that it's the political elite who also, many of them, not necessarily own, but have a high stake in the private insurance company. So they've got a massive political lobby, and you can't implement the form that curbs their power. So you there's a parallel in India.
So can we understand this whole, I mean, say, from the intervention of the private with the public as attempt for formalization of the economy? Because say, if you see the housing, around 80% of the housing solutions people have sought with the informal. So I don't know. I see it more of as an attempt for the state to go towards formalization of the
of this process.
Yeah, of the process when...
I mean, I think the health insurance is a clear marker. It's a clear marker.
Even I have listened to some presentation and it makes sense. The privatization of medical education has affected the medical, the healthcare system.
Of course,
don't think.
Anyone's question on insurance? Basically, insurance is definitely, I mean, insurance network, the companies are very much part of the healthcare system. And they are the ones who also kind of generate that kind of response or a demand from one side, the public, the other from the hospitals, I mean, the nexus that is there between the. And this is particularly seen in the American healthcare system, where the insurance companies are major players, insurance and the pharmaceutical companies. So they are private entities, and they are the ones who are deciding on the costs and the benefits. So that's a major thing, and that's a similar kind of a thing that we might be facing. And we have a range of insurance companies, and which are some that are linked to the hospitals, like Max is there, Max Medical Insurance,
Apollo
Munich. Apollo Munich.
Some of these are all like transnational companies, but they. It's interesting that even when the insurance sector was opened up in India for private insurance by Chidambaram, the earlier finance minister, it's not as if there were many takers, because the concern was that it was an unregulated private market and it was actually dangerous for them doing this. So what they did is the accommodation was tying up to specific hospitals. So they tied up with corporate hospitals. So if you bought a plan, you could get serviced in that particular hospital. But the private market has grown, but it has not grown substantially in this country.
And so is it, I missed a few answers, so is it predominantly, is it Indian capital that owns it, or a mixture of Indian and
No, there were some of them were foreign companies. Mm-hmm. But we also have Indian, Mediclaim and others are Indian companies. Mm-hmm. But the ones that tied up with the corporate hospitals were foreign. Bupa, for example, has a tie-up.
Yeah, because one of the things we identified in South Africa, companies like Netcare seem to have hospitals in South Africa, the UK, and India. And it seemed that, because this is one of our questions in the project, you know, are these actors in the PPPs the same across the countries? And it seemed that some of them are.
One issue, I think you could give us something. How do you assess the role of the doctors in a private, in a privately funded hospital or nursing home? Because they actually take recourse to over-prescription and get into the and they also make profit and they allow the nursing home to make profit as well. And the profit is illegally shared. So some of the practices, you know, there's total subversion of the process of diagnostic and this.
Well, that's fairly well known. And there's also kickbacks for prescribing these diagnostic tests. But I did a study with retired AIMS doctors and asked them how, you know, they looked at, I mean, I didn't want them to begin with the story of commercialization. So they did a take back on what happened to AIMS and what happened to the public sector. And all of them talked about how commercialization eroded the public sector. But what was very interesting is that generation of cohort of retired doctors who went into, say, Apollo or Max, many of them gave up their job and returned to smaller trust hospitals like Sitarampatlo. The reason is that they felt that this competition between individual doctors to earn revenue, and this was reflected in what Madhurima said in St. Stephen's, psychiatry wasn't able to really generate much money. So they told that psychiatry department, you closed down. So, you know, I mean, so moment you move into a revenue model, this is precisely what happens. So those which are high and those which are technology dependent produce much more revenues, like cardiology, you know, and dialysis now.
That then forces the doctors to behave in certain ways.
Absolutely.
They have to maintain this kind of competitive behavior in order to maintain their practice.
So when we say market principles introduced into public systems and non-profit systems, these are the consequences of that. That it fundamentally not only alters the behavior of doctors, but it alters the behavior of you as a patient. Like she said, you know, the idea of a good hospital is the facade, it's the architecture, it is the marble floors. You immediately think, oh, that's a good hospital. More technology is good medical care. So, you know, there has been a systematic way in which we start thinking and behaving about what is good medical care.
And then presumably that must impact, sorry, anyone else have a question? That must impact on the sharing of good practice between doctors as well.
Of course, there's no team approach. I mean, and that particular study, the AIMS doctors talked about, that they learned good practice by being part of teams. But in private hospitals, that whole, you are atomized,
sorry, individual,
and you are competing with each other.
Yeah, I think, we also missing out on one aspect of the pharmaceutical lobby in the PPP,
of course,
which plays a huge role in irrational and unethical care. So, and that is a huge part of where the OPs happen.
Can I just
come ahead and
say what
just
it's related to the pharmaceutical. It's the fact that we come across in our village is that people, when they go and pay to visit a doctor, they want to get medication because they feel that just being told you lie down, you sleep, you relax, and it'll pass is not, you know. So on the one hand, you have the pharmaceuticals who are trying to, you know, who obviously are lobbying and need to sell their stuff.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, people also believe that if they go and see a doctor, unless they get an injection,
yeah,
mainly an injection, but at the very least some antibiotics to be taken orally,
yeah,
right, that then they're not getting the service they're paying for. And I'm wondering how you've come across
I think there's a lot of doctor-induced behavior also. This idea of this injection goes back a long, has a long history. Because when you get an injection, whatever you're getting injected with, you get quick relief.
Yeah.
See, this whole, so then the association and the collective memory is, you get an injection, I can get back to work. I cannot afford to.
Even if I am doing the religious fast for 9 days, I have to go and take the saline.
It cures weakness. You know?
But this is very systematically cultivated in the patients.
Yes.
By the doctors.
Yeah.
Yes.
But those even pharmaceutical industries
yeah.
have like
and
big warnings with like, you know, you take this and
yeah,
then you
yeah,
shall
yeah.
be running
Absolutely.
Tomorrow. It works for them. So
and over the counter. Over the
it's a very strong thing in Latin America. And then there's a lot of literature about, you know, migrants coming to the UK and sort of complaining that they don't get anything from the doctor and the anecdotal kinds of things that there's
yes.
levels of expectations. So it's fascinating literature.
I think the commercialization thing is interesting. That's happened in the UK. And you're right, I think you can't separate the two. It's almost like you have to have commercialisation before you can have the PPPs. Because I was trying to unpick some of the stuff that's happening in our health sector. And the bureaucracy of how the money gets from the government to the service provider.
True.
I find it interesting how you phrase it, but it's so much paperwork.
Yeah.
Like, case related, it's yeah. So it's quite stifling. But you need to have that, so you have these independent
agencies.
Yeah, money generating entities, and then when you've got that, then you can in private sector in different ways. That's all part of the process.
It reminds me actually that more in Kent, I don't know when it's definitely about better though. We had the very first workshop on personal education, maybe, and more in Kent. And we had a lot of discussion about you can't talk about PPPs without talking about sort of commercialisation. Much more volume than you've got to kind of unpack the whole private sector.
Yeah, even how you restructure the public sector, then you have these entry points that facilitate the
government.
Yeah.
I also feel that, you know, like the analysis document which came out before the national health policy, the issues that it raised vis-a-vis the private sector and the lack of regulation and the underfunded practices, the clear it's a government document, and that doesn't get reflected in the policy at all. So in that sense, how do you have a private sector aligned to public sector goals is completely like misplaced. And so the law is coming right from there, besides what she pointed out, you know, strategic purchasing.
Exactly.
What is it? So what, knowing that all this is there, and then you get a policy which is completely disconnected from the reality, it seems like government is bent on promoting the
exactly.
Is there regional variations?
Oh, yes. I mean, I think we didn't touch on that, but Maharashtra, the southern states of Maharashtra, Andhra Pradesh, Tamil Nadu, and to some extent even now Kerala, they are the high private sector growth states, meaning you're talking about secondary and tertiary. Anyway, we have a very large informal and formal private sector for primary level care across the country. But these states have a very, very active and a very vibrant private sector, which predates liberalization. Which has had a very long history, and they're very closely connected not only to the urban, but also to the rural. A lot of the investments are coming from a particular caste group which had interest in sugar. Their agricultural base, the Marathas, who owned both land, Reddys and Kammars in Andhra, and the Chettiars and Mudaliars in Tamil Nadu, and the NRI diasporic legend. The return of the American Indian doctor. When you read about Apollo hospitals, it is a Reddy doctor who goes to Houston, practices, and decides to come back, uses the political networks. This is a paper I've done recently reading his biography. And manages to get the political class to
you know, we think policy is made very rationally.
Mm.
He actually prevails on the political class, e-liberalization, to say that you should make hospital an industry. She showed you the 1986 hospital becomes an industry. It's not out of a very well thought out process. It is the lobbying of this individual doctor using his networks from Tamil Nadu politics, the Congress government, reaches the center. Because otherwise in Delhi, if you're a Stephanian and if you've been to Oxford and Cambridge, your door's open to the political elite in a particular way. But if you are a regional person, you have to build those networks. It's fascinating.
Can you say you've written papers?
Yeah. I can send it to you. It will probably come out this year. It's in an edited volume.
Oh, right.
Okay. Why only health? I mean, health, there has been a private education and as you have seen, previous liberalization. But post-liberalization, is separate desire, talk to bureaucrats.
Yeah, they're completely.
Why you're looking at municipal government as a democratic entity in the first place? We are now trying to adopt the thinking where we train to adopt the thinking that we should run municipal government as a service industry. And this has been the language and terminology has been used in most of the government running institutes in the last 15 years. Not just Yashoda in Maharashtra, but I think every state has their own great program. Where the huge loans have been taken from our side on the name of capability. The capabilities have to be built first to adapt the thinking, the ideology, and the practice.
Can I
perhaps,
speaking up on some of the issues that have been said, so we have the private sector and then we have the political elites and private representing the private sector. So, you know, I'm wondering where is the glimmers of hope for us? So, is the medical profession is entirely, from what I understand, the medical profession is entirely with this? For instance, in the UK, the medical profession is not entirely bought off on all the commercialization that's happening in the NHS. There are actually sometimes strong voices against that. But so I'm wondering, is there anything, I mean, apart from you, but you are lone voices.
The majority of the medical profession is very much in sync with commercialization.
Yeah.
But there are institutions like All India Institute, etc., where there are voices for, you know, around questions of values, trust, etc. But they are certainly a minority.
Mm-hmm.
Because people who choose to stay in those big government hospitals, they do so out of a conscious
sense of commitment.
Because they are the top of the top in terms of the independent. They could get fantastic jobs at any hospital in the world with accommodating salaries.
So that's
and they
remains.
So they're in a
impact even on primary healthcare providers is so high that some of my friends who have been value-based who started with 30 rupees. Just the 30 rupees fee for preliminary checkups and, you know, general medicine. They have maintained it up to 50, but the impact which is coming from outside, they tried, okay, even they, I have prescribed something, why should I choose a particular company and go to a conference in Bali? And I asked, but ma'am, why you have started this? See, unless I go outside, even my patients do not look at me as a good doctor. So how do I mean, I've been trying to this is capturing even the minds and the values of some doctors.
Absolutely.
And
the private medical college that she said is actually the reason behind this entire thing, because you have a huge number of medical doctors who've paid capitation fees, who've actually come out, and the only thing to kind of, you know, what they do is to set up their shop and, you know, recover their entire money. Recover, it's almost like recovery. So then all of this is so attractive because I have already incurred huge loans to get my medical degree.
Just one point that these medical institutions, when they were established, they're given land at very subsidized prices, and this whole thing of catering to 30% or 25% of the patients from economic weaker sections. But that has not happened so far.
But there are people working to, for example, in Delhi, there's this advocate, Ashok Agarwal, who has been really, he's using social media, and you can write to him if you're in Delhi, and then he files cases on behalf of the patients and has got many patients have access to these facilities. So I think this role of the legal profession also in saving or at least to support the publicness becomes very important to have these kinds of avenues.
In fact, it's also interesting, we normally have monolithic understanding of various organizations,
yes.
But recently the Confederation of Indian Industries, the health group, started a conversation about bringing back ethics into medical practice, and it was an interesting initiative, and it's still on. I'm part of that initiative, where we tried to get senior doctors who were concerned about this question, maybe too in terms of the literature also.
Then I can share one such, I mean, effort to engage in this entire deal, liberalization, privatization, kind of alternative. When I was working in Prayas, it was my early organization, this entire privatization of public services in electricity, in water, in health was very strong. It also accompanied by emergence of independent regulatory authorities. And there was a big debate that do you want to really reject and shun kind of an approach where you always protest and sort of be against consistently about this, or do you want to really throw the baby out of the bathwater kind of, and do you want to engage rather, critique and engage in these regulatory agencies, try to democratize them, try to make them more transparent, and that transparency and democratizing kind of a process should be taken towards the primary stakeholders in the society. And
sorry, Brandon, I'd say goodbye to everyone. Thank you so much. Great to meet you. Thank you.
Bye. Today's discussion on four very important sectors, housing, water, education, and health. And I must thank all the participants who have come such a short notice, and all of you who are here, particularly the people who are the panelists of these different panels, like Amita, Darshini Madhavi, Mahadeviya, Eliza, Prasad, Shetri, and Abhay Shetri, who have chaired the urban housing session. Also, thanks to our panelists in the water session, NC Narayanan, Deepak Mandan, Suhas Vastre, and of course our own Pranjal. Pranjal deserves a separate thanks. Also thank to the invited in the education session, Himon, Simrat, Nandini Manjarekar for chairing the session, Anupam Pachodi, Shomenda, again thanks once again, Marie. Also for the health panel, I thank Jasmine, Ramabaru, Madhurima Nandini.